call this meeting to order. We have not been here for an hour, as the clock says. We will get that taken care of. Thank y'all for being here tonight. I'd like to call on Commissioner Loudermilk to offer the commission's invitation.
You pray with my heavenly Father as we gather here this evening. We just give you great thanks for all your blessings upon this county, upon our state, and upon our nation. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to exercise our rights guaranteed by the United States Constitution to assemble to go over the business of this government. We thank you, Lord, for the freedoms that we enjoy to do so. We thank you, Lord, for this wonderful county that we have the privilege to live in. We thank you for our people, county employees, especially our public service personnel. We ask that you watch over them, keep them safe as they keep us safe. And Father, as we conduct the business of this county, your county, this evening, we pray, Lord, that you just grant us wisdom to make decisions which will benefit our county and our citizens. And we just thank you once again for all your blessings, and I ask these things in the name of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
And now call on County Manager Randy Dowling to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Please recite the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First item on the agenda is the approval of the minutes from the regular session of October the 18th, as well as for, no, that's it. We do have a special call session on October the 31st. Do I have a motion?
Motion to approve both. Second.
Any changes, discussion, all in favor, signify by saying aye, raising your hand. Carries. There's one other one. There's also a work session which we had on November the 1st. Those minutes are also included. Do I have a motion on that?
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by raising your hand. Okay, I would like to make an announcement. We had item number 6 on our agenda for tonight on the new business fee schedules for the Community Development Department. And we are double-checking some numbers and whatnot, and so we are going to withdraw that or remove that from the agenda, and we will bring it up at some future time. So item 6, any of you who are here might have been here just to speak about that. Just wanted you to be aware of. Okay, appearance of citizens. First is Ricky Flanoy, Washington Road, Mr. Flanoy. Mr. Flanoy, if you would call up the commission office, we'll get those get answers for you. And we will certainly be happy to do that.
Thank you.
Next is Richard McKinney, who asked to speak to us from Antioch Volunteer Fire Department about an aerial ladder truck. McKinney? Chief McKinney?
Thank you.
You, sir.
Please bear with me. I handed Ms. Nancy, I handed just good notes for you guys to have. It's not really a prepared presentation, but good notes, I'm sure you guys have something there. I appreciate y'all letting me address the commission on this issue. It's a very important issue that Antioch Fire Department has come against, and we've been working on it for several years, and we just have not come to a conclusion that we can make it happen without the county's assistance in it. And one of the things, Antioch Fire Department, when we go forward with this, we are focused on the community. We're not looking at it as to just because we want something. We've taken all the implications of the positives and the negatives of what we need to make this work for the community. Our history shows that our personnel, they go above and beyond to make us above the average. Our ISO score rating shows that. There's a lot of departments that are still nines and tens that I visit on a regular basis that are doing everything they can. They just don't have the leadership to make it happen. Our mission at the fire department is to provide the best service possible to protect life, property, and the environment. When a homeowner calls us for assistance, they're expecting us to be able to produce the best possible outcome with what we have to work with. We see our homeowners in the worst possible state you can imagine. They're set aside yourself a lot of times. I just ask you to put yourself in their position when we go over this and you're looking at it. So if I'm able to provide something with a piece of equipment that's going to make things better, faster, quicker, safer for my guys, I want you to put yourself in our position when we go through this. Most of the county management systems view the fire service as a non-producing entity. Most communities or most county entities or county departments just look at the fire department just as an expense. We have pretty much proven ourselves to be somewhat self-sustaining, only on fixed operations, however, without capital expenditures. From 2004 to 2014, we did not receive a stipend from the county, per se, money given to us. That money was awarded to us, but it was turned around for truck payments. We purchased several apparatuses. So, for 10 years, we did not get any funding from the county that you can say we can live on. That money was basically to pay our debt. With the declining of our annual donations from probably due to the poor economy that we're experiencing, I do not believe that the income that we receive only from the property owners of the Antioch area will be significant enough for us to be able to go with this next program that we're trying to do. If we were to try to do this on our own, we would not be able to operate. The reason I'm bringing this for the Board of the Commissions, during the 2014 annual inspection of our aerial vehicle, it was noted that our aerial vehicle's frame was in excessive fatigue. In 2015, the frame had deteriorated even more. They told us that the rate of acceleration of the deterioration of the frame would not pass the next year. In May of 2016, the frame of the vehicle was condemned. They said that we could not even drive it on the road. It was not safe because the frame actually has a crack between the two tandems. If we drive around a turn at 30 miles an hour, it will more than likely crack and just fall apart. All inspections of the Antioch apparatus are performed by a third-party inspector. After this note was done, I had an additional inspector come in to inspect it to make sure that his findings were correct. The findings were the same. He told us the same thing, basically. It's not a repairable situation. The truck needed to be condemned. When we received the 2014 inspection, I started to look at pre-owned, reasonably priced units. I did not find anything out there that was reasonably priced that we didn't have to spend a very large sum of money to be able to put it back into operation. After the 2015 inspection, I employed through the Forestry Commission to begin searching for surplus equipment. They do have, Forestry Commission does have set up with government throughout the entire United States to purchase apparatuses at a minimum cost. There are no aerial trucks out there to get. There's quite a few other pieces of equipment, but not what we need. Currently, through all the government programs that we've researched through, there's no vehicles available that we're looking to be suitable for what our needs are. Currently, we've come up with an opportunity. Currently, there's an apparatus on the market that is in excellent condition and is local. It's in Griffin Fire Department. It's currently in service right now. They just purchased a new ladder truck. They're trying to get it in set up for operation, but they're still using theirs. All the preventive maintenance services have been done. All the tests are up to date. The x-rays are up to date. It's aluminum frame, so they have to x-ray every 5 years. Or not frame, but aerial. Where do we stand with this elevated water stream? ISO will change. We will go from a 4 to a 5. I've already worked all the numbers. It will definitely change. This will affect over 2,500 homes in our area, which in turn is going to increase the insurance premiums approximately $90 to $125 a year per homeowner. The Mount Hill Elementary School and the historical school site will be affected as well. This will significantly affect any multiple story buildings that we have in our area. The condos will be affected. There are 10 three and four story structures housing 78 homes. This device is also used as an elevated rescue unit. There are 38 second floor condos with 60 residents living above the second or above floor. This also affects the departments with mutual aid that we mutual aid with, which are Catawba, Northwest Terrace, and Hamilton. This will also affect their ISO rating. In the future, we have growth coming. The proposed plans will require two aerial units for the Antioch District, one to be housed at Station 1, the other to be housed at Station 5. For the most credit with ISOs, ISO inspection to be able to gain the most credit. They cannot be housed from any multiple structures or major water flow of 3,500 gallons of water or more. They cannot be housed more than 2.5 miles away from that location. The cost on this unit that we found that's pre-owned is right at $200,000. It's currently available. I had it on reserve for me. There are other departments looking at it. I have priced out new units, which we're looking between $900,000 and $1.1 million for a new unit. The truck that we're currently looking at is a 1995 E1. It's a 105-foot platform. We currently now have a 1985 100-foot platform. ISO requires us to have at least a 100-foot aerial device of some type because of the condos, because they are telling us that it is a four-story building, and that's what they identify with. If we go with a 75-foot ladder, which is a little bit cheaper, we won't get a full ISO credit.
What did you say the height platform was on
this? It's the one that we're looking at is 105-foot.
105.
Yes, sir. It's a 2,000 GPM pump. Our current one is a 1,500. It's an aluminum ladder. It is an E1 vehicle. That's all I have, sir. Any questions? No.
Are you in line for one of the 10 trucks this year?
Yes, sir. We've already put together the plan for that truck. That vehicle that we're expecting to get is also going to be a required truck for us to be able to operate as we are now. I have three trucks that are currently way out of age. One of those trucks would be replaced with that new truck.
If we were to purchase this particular truck, it'd be a 1995. How many years do you think that we would be able to get out of?
ISO identifies the vehicle to be a recognized unit as long as it passes pump test, aerial test, and structural test. The department that currently has it has had it for 13 years, I believe he said, and it's been well taken care of. I would say just, I'm going to say probably another 10, 15 years that it would last us with knowing the history of the truck. They purchased it from Austin, Texas 13 years ago. I do know what's been done to the vehicle recently. They just basically rebuilt the cylinders, the lift cylinders for the ladder. The crossway cylinders for the outriggers have been rebuilt. They did tell us that it, I don't want to say it needs tires, but it's beyond the limits of the tires that they like to run them at. He told me he'd put new tires on it. Currently, our trucks that we have now, when we purchased it, I guess 10 years ago, it was a 20-year-old truck. It was an 85. We purchased it approximately 10 years ago. We paid $38,000 for it. When we got it, we had to put, I'm throw a number out there, $30,000 in it to make it usable for us. And that was us doing the labor to get it to where it was usable. Even knowing that truck's condition when it came in, we got another 10 years out of it, keeping up with it. So based on the cost of its existence through the 10 years for a $38,000 price vehicle, it's done better than we get out of most used cars. You also got to keep in mind what the unit's used for and how it's used. It's a very heavy weighted vehicle, so it's going to take wear a lot harder.
If there was a fire tonight in those condos, how would you handle it?
Very delicately. I would probably say,
I have pictures, Mr.
We would, it'd be an automatic dispatch for Northwest Harris and for Catawba for manpower. We would work, the last time that we had a fire there, we ended up having, it was a vertical fire. Four apartments directly above each other, and that's all that we lost. If it would have gotten a little bit worse, then we would have had problems. But we ended up, when we got finished with everything and I was doing the report, and I did not realize I required this much assistance. I had 18 apparatuses there and I had 63 firefighters. That's what it took to control that fire. And that was just using what we had at that time. Currently, I do not have an aerial truck, so if it gets above the second floor, I've got issues.
Is an aerial truck and ladder truck the same thing?
Yes, ma'am. There's just different terminology. There's several different versions of it. Aerial truck, ladder truck. A platform actually has a basket on the end of it to where if you have what they call a stick, it's just a straight ladder. Mm-hmm. But we're actually needing a platform simply because of the elevation of height. Sure. That would cover the building. And I have found some just waterways, aerial waterways or elevated streams. They will not work because we need a rescue unit as well, or a rescue, something with the rescue capabilities of it. If you get just a waterway, you can get just a waterway of 75 feet. That will help control the water. But if I had a rescue situation, that I would need a different type of a truck. And those are available, but they're just not going to serve the purpose.
So if you had a fire tonight and people were stuck on the third or fourth floors, you just have to go up and get them?
Pretty much, yes, sir. Yes, sir. We do have the longest ladder that we have on any of our engines is a 24-foot extension ladder. Mm-hmm. That will get me to the second floor. And from the third floor, we just have to take each situation as it comes. We do have a 35-foot ladder. That's currently on the ladder truck now. If it came down to it, we'd figure a way to get it there, but we have no way to get it there. And it's a portable ladder. Mm-hmm. But if you want to call it a 35-foot ladder a portable ladder, it's a four-man ladder. Really, we wouldn't have a way to do anything with that. But there again, we at the school, That unit's also been used at West Point. Can't think of the name, Dayon Plan or something like that. They had a fire there at Dayon.
Dayon, yeah.
And we took it up there for assistance with West Point. There was four aerial devices there at that particular time of that fire, and there still wasn't enough. We still required them. The school, when we did the, it was eight or nine years ago, we did a county-wide exercise at the high school. We used it in that exercise. At that time, I think it was before Pine Mountain had their truck. I think it was before then that Pine Mountain would be coming to that as well, if there was an exercise or a call. Which the, in the county, which I know you guys are aware of this, the county has a mutual aid agreement for everybody. We all assist with each other, so whatever's needed is available. Whatever, and we all know what each other has.
Other than the schools, and at the business park, what other structures in the county would need to need an aerial truck?
The courthouse. I'm not really familiar with all the other structures that are in the county other than what I go by on a regular basis, but cables, we need one, which Pine Mountain would be the first on that location with an aerial truck. It would take us, I guess, 30, 45 minutes to get there with it, but it'd still be serviceable, usable. I'm sorry, sir, I don't know the answers to that, because I'm not that familiar with everything that's around.
Richard, this is something that you need an answer on fairly shortly.
Fairly quickly, yes, ma'am, because when I was talking to Captain Hamilton over there, he actually called me this afternoon at 3 o'clock and asked me if we were still interested in it. And I didn't know that I was addressing the commission board tonight. He said he had someone else that was looking at it. So, but he said he would prefer to sell it to us than them because it's, you know.
We're neighbors.
Yeah.
Close.
Is anything else needed to be done to the truck in Griffin?
As far as I know, we went and inspected the vehicle, and then I had someone else look at it with me on a different occasion. Well, not with me, but he went up there and looked at it. And the only thing that we said that it looked like it needed was tires, and then Captain Hamilton said that he would have his county put the tires on for us. But the truck is in complete operation, and they're using it now. And as far as I know, there's nothing maintenance-wise, inspection-wise, that needs to be done to it.
Is there any equipment on the one that has been condemned that can be used, usable, sold, anything?
Yes, we're actually going to need to transfer a lot of that equipment from that truck to the other truck.
Well, that's what I was wondering, yeah. if there's anything beyond that that's needed, or does that pretty much complete the package that you need?
The yes, ma'am. It would complete it. The truck that he's given me comes with the complement of ladders. It's coming with hoses. It's not coming with any nozzles. He will give me the nozzles that are on the basket, which are two 1,250 GPM nozzles. Those things are quite expensive, but he's given those to us. The basically everything that needs to make the truck function, I either have it off the old truck or it's coming with the new truck. So as far as going outside to buy more.
John,
I need to ask you a question.
Right.
I think the need is there, actually, that's my opinion. Not only for things in his district, which are some of the schools and the condos at the back one, also in other schools in the county and the courthouse. We started a few years ago having a fund and a couple of the special funds for this kind of thing when we need it.
Mm-hmm.
Solid waste has a significant amount. Is there a possibility of using that money in the solid waste capital fund?
It's your money. You put it there for them to use. If you want to reallocate it, you certainly can do so.
Okay.
Yeah, may irritate the daylights out of solid waste, but that's the way it is, you know. We've got, you know, it's what's the best use you can make out of that money?
Any idea what the amount is in the solid waste?
Yeah, I do, it's plenty.
To cover the 200.
No plans that they have for it this time?
No plans that they have for it this one time. I'm correct in that they have plenty, right, Paul?
Pardon?
Solid waste has plenty in their
fund.
More than cover this.
I guess just gonna have to be your call, and you can make that.
It'll be commissioner's call.
Yes, your funds, you've allocated it there for that purpose, but there's nothing that says you cannot reallocate it for a purpose that is more pressing than what they are needing for. Now, that's not saying, immediately after you do this, they come back and they say, hey, we've gotta have this and so, and you.
In my opinion, there's enough money there to cover any.
Contingency that they have.
Somehow another garbage truck was stolen, we could still cover it, so.
I think we could have insurance.
The solid waste is in the midst of going on bid for the truck.
Yeah, but there is money there, even over there. I was aware of that recently, our financial officer made me aware of that, number, and so, I mean, that is something that we could do if this commission chooses to do so. And I don't think it jeopardizes it at all if we were to do it.
Would we have to, as an accounting procedure, would we have to borrow the money from solid waste or just do an allocation?
I think you just move it. I mean, it's your money that you said belongs to them, it's in their account. I think Paul would agree that there's no borrowing to it.
Yeah, in solid waste, there's no, like you have in other enterprise funds, you have sometimes legal restrictions on the money, but in solid waste, there aren't any, so the money can be used however. And it could be loaned or it could be transferred. Basically, loan means they're going to have to pay it back. Transfer means it's gone.
Right. You know, it's basically what it sounds like to me is a savings account, a contingency account for them. And if it's sitting there not being used and somebody else has got a bigger priority than they have, certainly you could do that. But you may want to go back and eventually replace that.
Solid waste is healthy, so.
Yes.
I want to commend you for finding a list to be a bargain. I was expecting a price tag at least twice.
It's been a rough go for the last 8 months. I've looked at, I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with what I do, but I see fire departments in the Atlanta metro area every day. That's what I do. I go visit them. And I've been on the search for 2 years looking for an aerial device. Over the last 8 months, I really, really got serious with it, especially when they told us we couldn't use ours anymore. And I've made a lot of trips just to see trucks, and there's a bunch of junk out there. They're either way overpriced or they're not worth having. This is really the first one I've run across that was significant enough to.
Roughly a 20% of what a new one would cost.
But our fire departments, all of them, try their best to find the equipment that they need at the best price they can pump. Just got what, a pumper for $100?
The tanker.
A tanker.
I did get a tanker. It was through the surplus, through the Georgia Forestry Office. The truck cost us $100. Cost me $4,000 to get it here, $3,000 to paint it and letter it, maybe $4,000. And it's a better truck than our other one was, and it's better than I can ask for. So I've got $10,000, and it's priced at $133,000. So I got $10,000 and $130,000 out of price. And it's already paid for itself on a couple of calls that we've had.
But all of our departments do that. Out there searching for equipment.
Yeah,
Great job.
We appreciate it. Well, Commissioner Langston, this is your district.
Yes.
You also attend all the fire chiefs meetings, so if you'd like to make a motion.
I would like to make a motion that we approve the purchase of the aerial ladder truck and use the facilities funds to this.
I'll second that. Motion in a second.
And the title will come to the county.
Title will come to the county.
I think we've done that with all our other vehicles.
Yeah.
I would, before we take a vote, I assume it's a wee positive, but before we do, when, make sure you get something in writing about the new tires that they got.
Oh, I will.
Yes.
There's some not to exceed $200, because if you can get a bargain with that.
Well, okay.
Well, I've already beat him out of $49,000. He ordered $254, so.
Okay.
That's actually what it's on sale for now. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Brindley Mountain. Brindley Mountain's marketing it for him at $249.
All right.
Are we gonna put a not to exceed?
Not to exceed.
It's what, $200,000?
Is that okay?
It's only $200.
$200,000.
Yes.
All right.
It's, do you have sufficient funds for the relettering and all that?
Yes, ma'am.
You got it, okay.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second with a couple of add-ons to it. Any other discussion on this?
What will be done with the existing vehicle? How will it be disposed of?
We actually carried it to Columbus to scrapyard. They told us they would give us $1,900 for it. I told my guys to bring it back. So,
if that's a kind of vehicle, the board must declare a surplus?
Or is that's it, actually, that,
that's theirs.
That's ours. Yes, okay. I think that's ours. We are actually, I don't know what to do with it.
Okay.
It's a monster and it's in the backyard and I don't know what to do with it.
But it's not a kind of vehicle?
It is not a kind of vehicle. That's right.
Well, if they say it's irreparable, I don't guess there's much other option.
We're hoping the metal price will go up first.
Yeah, okay. Okay, that's a good question. Thank you, sir. All right, any other comments? All in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, appreciate it.
Thank you for all you.
Thank you, Richard.
Okay, any other citizens, Nancy?
Yes, sir.
All right, move to old business. There's been some discussion about CDBG grant for 2017. There have been several emails that have gone back and forth among commissioners and Ms. Michael and Mr. Valley. But I think. I believe the consensus was, and Randy, why don't you speak to that consensus?
Especially, I think it's our best interest to wait this time period, finish up the King's Gap project first, which is coming to a conclusion really soon. Finish that project up, locate a very good project for the 2018 cycle that will have to be begun this time next year and be submitted April 1st of 2018.
I know that a couple, in the course of our discussion and emails, a couple of other projects have been mentioned, probably worthy projects, but I think we do need, I think it's wise to put it off, not being, because that'll give us time to really look at those and begin to, there's certain things we have to determine and determine in, such as the residents in the area and their incomes and that kind of stuff. Rather than hurry into something, I think it's probably wise to just do that. But, I don't know that we, anyone else want to make any comments? I know, Jim, you had come up with a project that was possible to work. So.
My question is, we were told October 31st the project would be done. Do you know when it will be? King's Gap?
The status on that is EMC has told us that Robinson Paving will begin paving this week. The So paving should be finished the next, probably 10 days?
The original deadline was October 31st, but because we had that sole source thing approved by DCA, that pushed it back, so the notice to proceed was issued a couple weeks ago. So they've got really until December 31st to finish it now, but they're probably getting it done soon once they start, which is, like Randy said, it's going to be this week.
Pending this week, so it should be substantially completed for the next 10 days. But then the turf won't be established until it rains.
Right.
So we can't close out the documents until then.
Okay, so it's basically you have to, so you can't close up the documents until the time that, until next spring.
No, we're going to get change orders on that to take the grassing out and to adjust the driveway apron. It doesn't become that. We discussed this a couple of meetings ago. Change orders should come before you get the next meeting. So once the paving is done, it should be closed out within a very short time because there's not much left to do except the grassing, and we're going to do that.
The reason why I was asking this was, this I think was supposed to be originally finished a year ago.
Technically, it was supposed to be originally finished 2 years ago. Then you were correct, sir. We had had four extensions.
I was trying to be nice.
I know. Just being honest. Yes, sir.
Okay. I don't know that we really need to take a vote on this. It's nothing before you. It's kind of the general consensus, though, that we wait. Bypass this year and then move on. Yes. General consensus is that. So. Any other old business? All right, new business. Have the airport capital improvement plan, which was discussed in our work session before our last meeting. This is a 5-year plan for capital improvement expenditures at the airport. It is not something that we have to live by, phrase it out, by the five years. We do not have to do any of the projects in the years that is laid out, nor do we even have to do any of those projects. We certainly can change that as time goes on, but it is just sort of a rough roadmap, if you will, for some of the things that we might want to accomplish out there. So we have, we did rearrange some of these things to put projects in the first year or two that really require not very many funds at all from the county, because we did have a bunch of our money prepaid on the new taxiway. Most of that has been, we have now gotten the federal and state funds for most of that. There's still one or two more payments left to go on it. One of them is kind of the contingency funds and that type of thing. We had a good discussion in our last meeting. I would entertain a motion for the adoption of this plan.
I would like to make a motion that we adopt this proceed. Capital Improvement Program for 2018 to 2022.
Second.
We have a motion and second discussion.
I have one question just for clarification in case someone might ask. Any of these projects before they're approved must, or any expenditures you made must come before this board, right?
That is correct.
Okay, thank you.
And we can, as I said to Commissioner Langston, we can totally drop one of those off, or we can move it to the last year, or whatever you may want. Any other question or discussion? All in favor, please signify by raising your hand. Motion carries. All right, the next item was the fee schedules for community development, and that has been removed from the agenda. We will, upon final clarification of some of the numbers and Mr. Taylor, I think you were going to take a look at what might make sure that what we put in there is qualified. So, and I know that County Manager Dowling has shared with us a brief, very brief and quick thumbnail as to what we've done the last couple of years there. One year we made a profit because of an unusually high building permit. The next year we didn't make a profit, but I want to make sure that those are the numbers before we consider any changes to the current schedule, including any additions. And we have talked about some of those that probably do need to be made, but we want to make sure we're leaving it. So if two of you could just don't discuss that and make sure we're right, and Mr. Williams, if you would just kind of double check everything. Thank you. Appreciate it very much. Next item is, and I'm going to call on our attorney, Mr. Taylor. We have a proposed agreement transfer from Visela to DVD Transportation Services for the AWOS equipment at the airport. It's a very short agreement. It's going to be the same personnel doing the work. They've just under a new name.
Right. Visela, whatever, however you pronounce it, is basically has entered into an agreement to sell to DVT Transportation Services these portions of AWOS products. Basically, they're selling off this section. And it goes will go with the people, I think, will stay the same with this new company. You had an AWOS agreement, two of them, one for preventive maintenance you entered into in September of 2015, and then a contract for aviation data service, which also will be transferred. There are two separate contracts, and they were one-year contracts, but with your renewal rights under the rollover every year thereafter. Unless you sue and terminate. The preventive maintenance contract is billed, I believe, at $3,000 a year. It's $3,000 a year, and it's billed in one installment, and then the aviation data service is $1,200 a year. So you're talking about $5,000 worth of expenditures. In the contract, we took out some things in there, printed portions of the contract, but one thing we put in the contract that you have the right to terminate it without cause within 30 days written notice. So you've got a bailout clause if you need it in there. The contract is kind of a little bit unclear about whether or not they can assign it. You can't assign it without their permission, but I think it's broad enough that they can certainly, if they're selling off a division, then it was, I think they've got the right to do that. So I see no problem with that. We may want to get DT Transportation just to sign an agreement that they assume all the responsibilities of the company and will fulfill the contract same as the settlement of the contract.
All right.
And I'm not sure what AWOS is anyway, but we got it.
It's a weather operating system out at the airport, so that people do instruments. All right. So Fog comes over and fills the valley, folks can still find us.
All right, okay, I thought we were. AWOS, I thought it had maybe something to do with insects or something. Wasp.
All right, I'll entertain a motion.
I move that we approve the transfer of the, or assignment of the contracts from ASAL to DVT Transportation Services, provided DVT assumes all responsibility and liability of those contracts.
I'll prepare an agreement to that effect.
All right. Second. Motion is second. Any other discussion? All right. Taylor will share that agreement. That would be good. All in favor, please raise your hand. Motion carries.
All right, the next one is due to personnel changes. We need to authorize certain staff members to manage CD accounts. So there is a resolution that has been prepared here to authorize Randy Dowling, the county manager, Nancy McMichael, county clerk, assistant county manager, and Christy Searcy to be approved as signatory.
Make a motion to approve the resolution.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion?
Yes. These three banks, one is in Atlanta, one is in Pasadena, California, and the other one is Troy, Michigan. We are a local government. We spend a lot of time and effort trying to increase the local economy. We go out and do business with banks all the way across the country. You know, sometimes you, by offering banks basically 10 cents on the dollar, for every $10 you give them, they lend out 100 locally, local banks. That's all I have to say.
This resulted from several years back when the commissioners gave the finance people at that time the authority to shop around for the best deals for CDs, and they went several places, as you can tell. That's how it evolved.
But I mean, the reality is those things are very small differences. There aren't very much money at this time anyway, but they're very small differences.
You know the terms of free CDs?
I do not.
I'm not sure.
Exactly. Somebody's got to get the names changed, otherwise we can't do anything.
No, I understand, but I'm just thinking about...
They're under 1%, I'm really pretty sure of that.
Okay, so...
Like at 0.8.
Right, 0.6, 0.8.
So they're not all that...
Depends on how far out you go. Further out you go, the higher the rate is, but we haven't bought any since I've been here.
So they're about 3 years old, 3 or 4 years old at most.
But we don't know the term of each one, approximately?
No, until they get news that we can't find out.
Well, that may be the way to look at it, is they're visited or something.
Oh, yes.
Before they're reinvested.
Oh, I'm sure.
Oh, do we get, is there a maximum that's insurable on these?
Yeah, it's $250,000. Normally we... I mean, I haven't bought any since I've been here, but normally the ones that are there are all at 248 or 249. So they're all within the FDIC.
The commissioner's loans and the amount that could be
done. Yeah, it's a discussion. So we do have to spread. We don't have that many banks here. Yeah. So
I do have to stage back to some degree because I want to stop and look. And actually, both local banks, if you look at it, but I mean, the banks have to guarantee 110% of the money that you lend.
Even above the 250,000?
That's George Block.
Okay. So it's certainly something to consider as they do mature. We look at those. Okay. Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Wood. We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor of approving these signatures, please signify raising your hand. Motion carries. Any other new business? Okay, new county manager, update on project. Mr. Dowling?
Mr. Chairman, Board of Commissioners, in my 2 weeks here, I've visited almost every department on site, talked to a lot of folks, and I'm preparing a list of what I call the program of work. A list of all the projects the county is currently working on or need to be working on that's budgeted or funded in some mechanisms of this watch. So I'm going to hit some highlights. This is not all inclusive, but I'm going to hit the highlights here in a few minutes. Number one, complete Ellerslie Park using proceeds from Land South, $360,000. That project is in progress. We have prepared a conceptual budget schedule. We're continuing to meet on that project to review and coordinate. So that project is going fast and furious. We hope to be finished by next April. It opens in public. That is our goal. You know, that includes two pavilions, two playgrounds, trails, parking areas, landscape areas, park benches, trash cans, picnic areas, a passive ball field. That's all in, contained in the plans. Again, we're having county staff perform the work, and so, and perhaps a dock into the lake. So this will be a great asset to the county, and we're working on it diligently, and so it should be finished, hopefully. Our goal is to have completed it open to the public in April.
While you're on that, just a thought, we do have 7 acres across 85, approximately 7 acres across seven, and it has no restrictions on it. I don't really know what sits next to that, but that is for us to utilize or sell, whichever we may want to do it. Might be possibility of having a drive-through recycling place, too. It's just a possibility. And if not, if we don't want to use it ourselves, then just sell it.
We'll look at it.
Yeah, just since Commissioner Loudermilk won't be here to remind us of that extra 7 acres, I just want it on your radar screen that
I understand.
We don't want to forget that.
Another project is library construction. I'm using various funding mechanisms, SPLOST 2009, SPLOST 2014, state funds, and various donations. The county did receive last week 3 proposals for construction manager at risk. We are going to interview those 3 companies November the 21st to make recommendations to the board on who to select. So that project is moving. I talked to the architect this afternoon. We had a great discussion. He's about 33% completed with the plans. So the plans are going on, and a construction manager at risk should be forthcoming. The 2017 LBIG list will be coming to the board, hopefully on December the 6th, the next meeting, because my state law has to end by December 31st. So we are getting the 2017 LBIG list prepared for the board's approval, and that's their annual repaving program funded by the state DOT. And the county's contribution by formula, that the county's grant award from DOT is $693,183.33. And the county has to match that 10% for a total project cost of $762,501.66. So those roads are coming to the board, hopefully the next meeting. Pate Park Playground, the Parks Director is preparing specs for that playground to use from SPLOST 2004 funds. We are in the process of acquiring Mars Hill Drive and West Mars Hill Drive for maintenance purposes. And all right-of-way has been acquired on those two drives, and the county attorney is preparing a resolution for acceptance for the next meeting. Paving Heritage Road, all the right-of-way has been acquired except for 3, and we're going to pick up that ball and run and hopefully acquire the 3 remaining right-of-way deeds. And the Pine Mountain Ballpark restroom project of about $50,000 from SPLOST 1999 funds is in progress, and the director of facility maintenance will be on the site tomorrow working on that project. And this project, when it's finished, will close out the 1999 SPLOST fund. Again, that is just the highlights of the project we're working on. We're going to have staff meeting tomorrow at 9 o'clock, and the staff will go over these, have more details, add some more, and I'm going to get this out to the board by the end of the week. And then update the board on a constant basis.
Okay. Very good. Thank you, sir. Any other questions or any other projects that the commissioners want an update on?
East Mars Road.
Mars Hill Drive, you mentioned.
Is that the same one?
It's Mars Hill, West Mars Hill. There's no East Mars Hill.
Okay, I'm sorry.
That was the same direction as west.
Yeah, it looks like you're going west and you're going north. Or north and you're going west. What is the status on that?
All the right-of-way has been acquired, and the county attorney will prepare an acceptance resolution for the next meeting.
There was one parcel that was a holdout. We went back and wrote him another letter, and I think we got a and correct address that it was getting to, the correct entity that it should have been going to. He signed the right of way deed and came right on back. So we got all the right of way we need, didn't have to deal with it.
Anything else? Thank you, Dallin, appreciate that. Mr. Taylor, Danny Leiter notice.
Yes, sir. Unfortunately, we've got another Danny Leiter notice. As you well know, state law requires that anytime the county sued, on any type of tort, or damage type situation, that it has to give, among other things, has to give the plaintiff, the aggrieved party, has to give a notice of the possible litigation. That has to be done within 1 year of the date of the that the event occurred, and then the lawsuit has to be filed within 2 years of the date it occurred, which is in accordance with state law. But if you fail to give a notice within the 1 year, then you're barred from filing anything within 2 years. So we have received a ad valorem notice from a firm in Atlanta that regarding a prisoner who died at the Harris County Prison. He was playing basketball and he died on the court. It was probably an anthropologist, I think. But they have claimed that there was some negligence on behalf of the county, and they're claiming $5 million worth of damages and for the wrongful death. And so I certainly would recommend to you that you deny the in-line notice, and I notify ACCG Irma of their in-line notice so they can be prepared to, you know, if it is filed.
All right, thank you, sir.
Chairman, I make a motion to deny the anti-lottery notice.
I'll second.
Motion to deny, and a second. Discussion. All in favor, signify by raising your hand. Motion carries.
Yes, sir. There is a need to go into executive session and look at discussion of litigation and also personnel.
All right.
Brief.
All right, I'll make that motion to go into executive session for litigation and personnel. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Sit.
I can't.